Hi, I'm dentist Saloni Jain, and in this video we are going to continue with pemphigoid, that is the second type of pemphigoid, namely the mucous membrane pemphigoid. And this is the end of pemphigoid. As I've told you, there are three types, and the two main important ones from our point of view being the bullous pemphigoid, for which the video is already being made. So I'll give the link in the description box and also pop an I button. I would highly request to watch that video first, because these both are types of pemphigoid, so many things are similar in this, but obviously some striking features are there which we are going to see in this video. Also, I would request you to first watch pemphigus actually, because this is all a family of autoimmune blistering diseases, right? So watch pemphigus first and then carry on with bullous pemphigoid and mucous membrane pemphigoid for a better and best understanding, I would say. So now let's get into the video, that is your mucous membrane pemphigoid. Mucous membrane pemphigoid, as the name itself suggests, that is affecting the mucous membranes. So now what mucous membranes are involved, that we'll see. But most commonly or most dominantly it affects the mucous membranes. That's why it is known as mucous membrane pemphigoid. Okay. The other names are cicatricial or cicatricial pemphigoid, whatever you want to pronounce it. So it's cicatricial or cicatricial pronunciation, and ocular pemphigus. Now these two things you'll get to know later in the video why these are called as cicatricial or ocular pemphigus. So let's see the introduction. So it is an autoimmune blistering disease. Again, since I said it's all the pemphigoid, all are a family of autoimmune blistering diseases. So several times I've told you autoimmunity, as in when the body starts killing your own healthy cells, that is autoimmunity, which results in blister, that are vesicles and bulla, small eruptions, fluid filled eruptions on your skin. So that is autoimmune disease, predominantly affecting the mucous membranes including the mouth and the oropharynx, conjunctiva, nares and genitalia. Okay, so predominantly it affects the mucous membrane of your oral cavity, contrasting to the bullous pemphigoid where we studied it as a rare manifestation. That's why I said and highly request that do watch the videos in sequence, that is first pemphigus, then moving to the bullous pemphigoid and then mucous membrane pemphigoid, because everything is covered again and again, and this is almost I'm repeating things. So it includes your mucous membrane includes your mouth, oropharynx, conjunctiva, nares and genitalia. Okay, so that's why it is known as, now it is clear, that's why it is known as ocular pemphigus, because these eyes, your eyes or your conjunctiva of the eyes or the mucous membrane of the eyes are predominantly or commonly affected in mucous membrane pemphigoid along with the oral cavity. So that's why it is also known as ocular pemphigus. Cutaneous involvement, that is skin involvement, shows dense blisters and erosions, often on the head and neck and sites of trauma. Blisters heal with scarring and pigmentation. So this word, healing with scarring, is actually the meaning of cicatricial word. So this cicatricial or cicatricial word means to heal with scarring. Okay, the healing with scarring process is known as cicatricial, and since the blisters heal with scarring, that's why it is also known as cicatricial pemphigoid. Okay, sequel of mucosal involvement includes, so following the mucosal involvement, once the oral mucous membrane or your conjunctiva or the mucous membranes of your nares and genitalia, once the mucous membrane are involved, then what happens? So if the mucous membrane involvement occurs of the eyes of the conjunctiva, so this follows by decreased vision, blindness, supraglottic stenosis with hoarseness of the airway obstruction if oral cavity and oropharynx are affected. So you can make out this, like these will be the sequel, since most commonly the mouth and the eyes area are affected by mucous membrane pemphigoid. So these are the sequel which are seen, the following involvement of the mucous membrane. Talking about the etiology, almost the same as bullous pemphigoid, so check out it. You already know that this mucous membrane pemphigoid and bullous pemphigoid are subepidermal blisters. Subepidermal, as I've told you in the bullous pemphigoid video also, that the blisters are going to be present below the epidermis, and below the epidermis means between the dermis and epidermis, right? So there also we discussed that there are autoantibodies, mainly IgG, that is IgG may be IgG4 type. to a lesser extent IgA and IgM are also there, but common ones are IgG and to that also Ig4, which are targeted or directed against the basement membrane zone target antigens. So two major antigens are associated with mucous membrane pemphigoids. These are nothing but your bullous pemphigoid antigen 2 and lamellin 5, also known as epilicrin. The whole story with all the explanations and necessary diagrams have been done in bullous pemphigoid video. So do watch that video so that you get a better understanding. It's almost the same, nothing different, okay? Accumulation of IgG has been documented between the laminins 5 and type 4 collagen present at the dermal epidermal junction. So this thing is also very clear. Now since this is sub-epidermal, so blistering is going to occur between the dermis and the epidermis, and since the blistering was going to appear there, so your IgG will be directed there where the basement membrane is present between the dermis and the epidermis, and there the antigens will act and there the blister will form. So definitely IgG, because it's going to act at that junction, so accumulations of IgG will be shown. So the various studies have revealed the accumulation of IgG there, okay? Now we'll move on to the clinical features. Moving to the clinical features, so if you have been following my videos, we usually start the clinical features with SAC, that is SAC, that is your sex, age and common site. So the sex is that females are 2 times more commonly involved than males. So here it is predilection for females. Then the age group it commonly affects, so the peach age group is of 40 to 50 years age group, that is elderly, definitely your old age or elderly people. And then the common site being the oral mucous membrane, that is the oral cavity and the conjunctiva, that's why it is also known as ocular pemphigus, because most common sites are your oral mucous membrane and the conjunctiva or your eyes, okay? Though the lesions also occur on the skin and other mucous membranes of the nose, esophagus, larynx, pharynx, vulva, vagina, penis and anus, that is genitalia also, nose also, oropharynx, pharynx, everything. Typically these lesions heal by scar formation. Now these are talking about actually the cutaneous lesions, okay? So the cutaneous lesions commonly heal by scar formation, which we have studied, right? That's why it is known as cicatricial or cicatricial pemphigoid, because they heal by scar formation. So usually when it's on cutaneous, the appearance is on your nose, esophagus, pharynx or genitalia. So there they appear by scar formation. But you will get to know the oral manifestations when it occurs in the oral cavity. They do not scar actually. Ocular involvement is most serious complication of this disease. Definitely, as I told, the most common sites being the oral cavity and the conjunctiva. So oral manifestations we'll see. So the second being your conjunctiva. So it is actually, because eye is a very sensitive part, and ocular involvement is the most serious complication of this disease. Initially there is conjunctivitis. Now every one of us, if anybody says, tell us an inflammation of eye, everybody of us will say conjunctivitis. Conjunctivitis is that common term which is present, which we all know, right? So initially there is conjunctivitis, which is followed by adhesion between the palpebral and the bulbar conjunctiva, which causes obliteration of the palpebral fissures with opacity of the cornea, leading to blindness. Okay, so you have to remember this. This we talked in the introduction also, that complications could be sequel of mucous membrane involvement could be in eyes, that is blindness. So you have to remember that the inflammation or this mucous membrane pemphigoid initially occurs in the form of conjunctivitis, then it starts with the adhesion between the palpebral conjunctiva and the bulbar conjunctiva, which causes opacity of the cornea, leading to blindness. Also some additional things follow, like scarring of the eyelashes, that is known as symblepharon, eyelid turned inwards, that is entropion, and when eyelid is turned inwards, the rubbing of the eyelashes with the cornea, that is known as trichiasis. So three terms are important which you have to remember here, along with blindness as the consequence. So these are your symblepharon, your entropion and your trichiasis. Now since a small lame trick to remember, that is trichiasis. Trichiasis means three. Tri means three. So three things are there. Okay, so from trichiasis, remember three things are there. So firstly is scarring of the eyelashes. Now if you imagine, if your eyelashes starts falling or they scar away or they fall away, so you will be simply frowned on. Like you will be frowned as in you will be like this, you'll be surprised, right? So to relate with, this is a very lame trick, but I think if you'll listen to this 2 to 3 times or you'll all repeat it 2 to 3 times, you'll definitely remember this. So scarring of the eyelashes will simply leave you simply frown. So that is simply frown. Break it like that way. So scarring of the eyelashes leaves you simply frowned. That is your simply frown. Eyelid turned inwards. So your eyelids are turned inwards, right? So that means your eyelid are entering in. So that is known as entroin, entropion. So from there you can imagine. So eyelids turning in, that is their entering in. So entropion, that is A hata do, so it's in, entroin. So that way you can remember entropion. And then rubbing of the eyelashes with cornea. When your eyelids will roll in, so your eyelashes will come in contact with cornea. And so there is going to be touching. So it's with T, that is trichiasis. So this is just a lame way to learn these three terms. So don't you don't forget them, okay? Actually, this might not be given in many books. It's additional kind of things to fetch extra marks if you want to. So if you forget this also, then it's important. But till blindness, you have to remember. Moving on to the oral manifestations. So the most consistent oral lesion to occur is on gingiva, that is involving the gingiva. Now, though bullous pemphigoid we have studied, there the oral manifestations or the involvement of oral mucous membrane is rare, still there we studied what will happen if oral mucosa is involved, and that is similar to this. So the most consistent oral lesion to occur is in gingiva, though it may involve, though further it may involve the palate also, the buccal mucosa also, but the most common to appear and consistent to appear is on gingiva. Mucosal lesions are vesicubulus. Okay, so vesicubulus as in blisters, erosions, ulcers, these are going to be formed on your gingiva, which are thick walled, and for this reason, because they are thick walled, so they may persist for 24 hours to 48 hours before rupturing and desquamating. Rupturing, that is rupture, and desquamating means shed off kind of. Gingiva is extremely erythematous and red, and may desquamate even due to minor frictional trauma, like desquamate that it may just put off, or it may just shed off, or it may just get removed off. After rupture, the epithelium is lost, leaving a raw eroded bleeding surface, and oral lesions rarely scar. Like there is no scarring seen on oral lesions, okay? But on cutaneous lesions, the scarring is definitely seen. Moving on to the histological features, which are same to the histological features which we have discussed in bullous pemphigoid. So here also in electron microscopy, there also I told you that histological features are nothing but the etiopathogenesis, the etiology and the clinical features which you have studied. So it is all the clubbing of all the features. So as you know that the vesicles and bullas are subepidermal in origin. So in electron microscopy, you will see the vesicles and bullas which are subepidermal, that is between the dermis and epidermis. Then there will be no evidence of acantholysis. The basement membrane structures appear, yeah, this is now a difference between the mucous membrane pemphigoid and the bullous pemphigoid thing. There the basement membrane structures appears to detach with the epithelium. It was not the same there, okay. Contrasting to that, here in mucous membrane pemphigoid, the basement membrane structures appears to detach with the epithelium from the connective tissue. The whole of the basement membrane with the epithelium is detached from the connective tissue, and chronic inflammatory infiltrate in the connective tissue in the form of lymphocytes, plasma cells, eosinophils, etc. are present. So almost the electron like features are same, with striking less differences, less of our 2 to 3 differences that still prevail. That's why that's a separate entity, right? So also, if you do immunofluorescence studies, that is your direct or indirect immunofluorescence, you are going to see tissue bound basement membrane zone antibodies circulating also, because they are present in the serum of that person, and also tissue bound that are already present on the basement membrane. As I have told you several times in the etiopathogenesis, we have discussed that the antigens and the antibodies are targeted on the basement membrane and everything happens there. So that is going to be present also and circulating, because the patient has this disease. So circulating can also be found in the serum. So nothing much in the histological features. And moving to the last part, that is treatment. So again, the goal is to suppress the extensive blister formation, to promote healing and to prevent the scarring. So patients with the oral lesion should avoid any mechanical injury from food, toothbrushing or intraoral appliances, because here the gingiva becomes very much, you know, transformative at times, like it sheds off easily. So person has to take care that he has to avoid mechanical injuries from any kind of hard food stuff or toothbrushing or intraoral appliances. Also, topical steroid applications can be done if it is cutaneous, so on the skin they can apply, or even flexible mouth guards can be fabricated to use as carriers for corticosteroid medication, and then the person can put it on. And if not topical steroids, then systemic steroids and immunosuppressant therapies can be given. So in and all, this disease is a very serious disease because it has got a very lot of complications. Like, as you know, if it increases, then it can lead to blindness, your visual loss. Also, it can lead to esophageal strictures or even airway stenosis and obstructions. So it is a kind of serious disease, and it really takes a long time to heal and to treat also. So this is all about mucous membrane pemphigoid or your cicatricial or cicatricial pemphigoid. I hope you understood this, and with this we end up with pemphigoid. In the upcoming video, we'll deal the differences which we see between pemphigus and these two types of pemphigoid in common. So stay tuned for that, and if you understood this video, then please like, share and subscribe to our channel. Also, one more thing, that the video is being made separately on a giveaway thing which is going on right now. So do check that. I'll give the link in the description box and also pop an I button. And stay tuned, and thank you so much.